Welcome to Berks Arts Monthly Program here on BCTV. I'm so excited to see you again. My name's Mamie Covell. I serve as the Community Engagement Coordinator for Berks Arts. We are joined here with Kevin Brett of Soul Imagery, who is a local photographer and artist who photographs in many mediums, specializing in live concerts and events, but also your work spans so many wonderful things. So I'm looking forward to chatting about it today.
Okay, great. Thanks. I'm happy to be here.
Thank you. And we're here in your studio today. Just being here, you can kind of see your personal art taste expressed all over. So what made you want to be an artist? What was the first thing that got you?
Very young, ever since I can remember, my grandmother was an artist. And she painted, and I really enjoyed what she did. And she kind of guided me along and got me a little painting kit, drawing kit, and got me started in that. But I've always really enjoyed it and been drawn to it.
Was photography the first, or was it painting that got you into the artistic expression?
It was drawing and painting and things like that were first. Mm-hmm. And then I found a love for photography right after high school.
Wow. You do a lot of figure work, both in the visual arts that I've seen, the drawings and sculpture stuff, as well as the photography. What is it about the figures that draw you in so much in your work?
I think a figure can be very expressive just in itself without any sound.
Yeah.
And the way the light can play on a figure is fascinating. There's infinite possibilities with that. And that's what's kind of intriguing to me.
Beautiful. And did the work, I see that the series of photographs on your website, do you have a favorite recent series that you've created? I saw the quarantine quintet was up. Those are really cool photographs. I imagine that was an interesting time. I guess you couldn't work with figures, but birds caught your fancy then.
Yeah, and that kept me sane. Mm-hmm. They were orphan eggs that were in front of the house, and a fox attacked the nest and stole some of the eggs. And I rescued the rest of the eggs, and that's how that came about, and hatched them, and had the five ducks for that summer. But as far as the fine artwork, I like doing a lot of conceptual work. I've been doing a lot lately with using the same person in the photograph, but having multiple images of that person within the photograph, kind of tell a narrative, so to speak, and do it that way. That's what I've been doing in the projects, and I want to get started again now that people can actually get together again and be safe somewhat.
What was your first shoot post the lockdown where you got to actually work with another being?
It was August Jazz Fest.
Exciting time, yeah. So I know as we've been hanging out in your studio photographing for the Fastlight Art Exhibit, I got to hear a little bit of your music taste. So your love of music impacts your photography through concert photography. How do those two worlds blend for you?
They're synchronized. If I'm not into the show or into the music, the photos aren't the same.
Yeah.
It's as simple as that. And typically I am. There's very, very rare occasions where it just, doesn't do anything, but that's very rare. But I found very early on, if I can get into the music and really immerse myself into the music, I use that in shooting. Mm-hmm. And it just kind of works. I can't really, it's kind of hard to explain.
Yeah.
But it's a symbiotic thing.
I love to see the real movement in your photographs, looking through the photos from the festivals that Berks Arts has put on that you've beautifully photographed. There's moments on stage, whether an artist is winking or just having a small moment, and you kind of capture that. Is it a constant shooting, or do you kind of feel the moment? How do you capture that? Those special moments.
That really depends. Sometimes it's just by luck.
Yeah. The best kind.
Yeah, I have to be at the right place at the right time, looking in the right direction. Mm-hmm. Other times, musicians that I've photographed often, I get to know them. Mm-hmm. and what they do and how they present themselves on stage and different things that they do at different times. Especially if I shot a band over and over again, you get to know them, and especially in some cases we're friends, and that really helps. Mm-hmm. So, yeah, and then to get the relationship, if there's a relationship built between myself and the artist on stage, there can be that interaction with the lens from the artist, which is nice to have sometimes too.
Yeah. Do you have a favorite artist to photograph that you feel like that relationship has evolved to that level? I mean, I'm sure there's a few.
there's one that I photographed probably the most and photographed any other band, mm-hmm. which is Lucas Nelson and Promise of the Real. We became very, very good friends about 10 years ago. And I, when they come around, they have me come and shoot their shows. And that's one of those ones where I really know their set. I know all the band members were friends, and I've learned what they do on stage and when they do it, how they interact with each other at different times. So that really helps. That really helps. And just being friends and getting into their music is the main thing.
Yeah. I think there was also such an energy that was brought about on stage in that post-quarantine period, just that happiness. And looking at those photos, particularly from August, at Jazz Fest, when those artists were just so excited to be there, I'm so grateful that was captured in that way, because the energy is just, the fans were so happy and the musicians were so happy. What was that like to be in between? Because you were really standing between the artist's first moment and the audience as well.
Yeah, the best seat in the house for the first three songs in 10 minutes, whichever comes first. Yeah. But no, that was a very unique experience to feel that, like, yeah, in between that. I mean, I'm in between the interaction of the artist and the audience. And yes, you could really tell in August that everybody was just thankful mm-hmm. to be out and enjoying live music and just enjoying each other and each other's company. It was special. It was very unique. That was, you could feel it.
Yeah.
You could definitely feel it.
In your journey to live events, how did that begin? Was there a particular concert that you were just independently photographing and then it kind of snowballed, or how did you really get into it? Because now you're kind of the go-to guy for this, but how did that come to be?
Oh, it was about, I have to look at my passes over there on the wall. Yeah. But it was during Jazz Fest, because I was a new artist in the building as a photographer, and I got to know people around the Goggle Works and some of the people in the Berks Arts at that time, and they asked me to shoot. It was a Dave Koz show, mm-hmm. and I said sure. And then, yeah, that had to be like 15 years ago. I shot that. I look back at those photos; they were okay. They were all right. But as I was saying, as time went on, finding those things that made the photographs better. Mm-hmm. The relationships and enjoying music and getting into it, that really helped. But it was about 15 years ago, it was the first one.
Wow, I didn't know that Jazz Fest was like the little spark that had that.
Yeah, it was.
That's awesome. Do you listen to the artist's music while you're editing their photographs? Because I know editing is so time consuming. When I look at your photos, I'm always so curious if you're playing other things while you're editing the photos, or if you're listening to the artist that you're staring at.
It could be anything.
Yeah.
It could be. As we were listening to earlier, mm-hmm. photographing the artwork from the students, it can be an eclectic bunch of bands or types of music. Might have that playing in the background. Just might have the TV on just for noise. Mm-hmm. I don't know if I really listen to anything while I'm editing the photographs, because mm-hmm. I'm just too focused on what I'm doing when I'm doing that. It's just more for noise.
Yeah. In the photos where you have multiple figures that are the same individual, what does editing look like for that? Do you kind of overlay the pictures? In looking at your work, you really can't see the different photos. So how does...
Yeah, it's a process.
Yeah.
For those where I'm doing the same photograph, I mean, the same individual, but in different positions within the photograph, the camera's set up on a tripod. So there, the camera doesn't move. Once I take the first... I take an image of the background with nobody in it, just the scene, whatever scene I'm using. Excuse me. And then I'll take the pictures, each one in the positions I want, with put the person in those positions in different outfits or whatever the case may be, in different areas to photograph, and then post-process it when I get home. I have all these photographs with the same scene in the background, but then I just layer them and then erase parts of one. I put the original background photo as my base photo with nothing in it. So then I have that background
to stack on.
Then I just stack on that and then erase where I need to erase so the others come through. Mm-hmm. And it's just built on that.
I've noticed in those series, it's very, related to nature in a way. The photos are outside, there's water involved, there are these figures. How does nature play a role in your photography?
I love being in it. Mm-hmm. It's a peaceful place for me. It means a lot to me. Ever since I've been a child, I've been in the woods, running around, playing in creeks and ponds. And it's just a personal relationship with just being out. And, mm-hmm. And I think it can, I don't know, it adds a personal element to the photos of mine, even though some of the things, the subjects in it might not be. There might be other people, but the settings, I'm glad you asked that because I think it made me first realize the settings are more of a personal thing for me, mm-hmm. than the concept that I have going on within that setting is something else. But the setting itself is the root, I would say, of the image. Because that sets the mood.
Of course.
That sets the mood for it. Now, a lot of the different things can happen within that mood, but it's that base setting for me. And it's more cooperative.
Yeah, it's so, also the textures that you see in the woods, whether that's, you know, the soil, the stone, the trees, the water, the sky, everything is just, there's so much depth in those photos. You can really see what that is. And when you see just a little slice of the woods and you spend more time looking at it, you realize what's there. Whereas when you're on a hike and it's everywhere, sometimes it's not as easy to be mindful of just how beautiful what you're standing in is.
Oh, no, yeah. And that's what you said about the depth. Because a lot of the concepts that I have in mind, there's a lot of depth in those itself. So having that deep background with all that depth really builds on that.
Yeah.
And that's what I try to look for.
Absolutely.
But I've done stuff in here too, concepts in the studio. Doesn't really matter, but I prefer outside. I prefer the natural settings.
Sure.
I think sometimes city settings or urban settings, there's some elements of those that might be too distracting for what I want.
Mm-hmm.
Be it architecture or whatever the case may be with the background things, might be too distracting. But I think the natural element, everything just for me just flows better.
Sure. The costumes I also find really particular, like they're pointed in the flow of the dresses. Is it the gowns that brings the setting, or is it a time period that you're going for, or do the costumes particularly relate to the concept behind the series?
They do for me because I don't want it to look too contemporary right now.
Yeah.
And plus, the period clothing, a lot of the gowns and stuff, which a lot of the different artists in the building here have given to me over the years, they have more texture,
mm-hmm.
and they have more depth, as we were talking about, than more some contemporary clothing, like with the lacy and the flowy and the style. I like in that, because I said the contemporary, I don't want it to look too contemporary.
Yeah.
Kind of a timeless look I'm looking for.
Sure. It's also, the clothing is very expressive in itself, depending on how it's laid or how it's laid on the person. There is a lot of kind of emotion in the shape of those clothing that you can see.
I say this sometimes in my conceptual pieces, everything within that photograph is a character in a motionless play. That's how I look at it. Everything, be it to the background, the rock here, the way the clothing flows or the dress flows. Yeah, everything is a character.
Is it a kind of moving and agile planning process, or do you know exactly what you want something to look like before you get behind the camera? I'm curious because you're so laid back. So I'm wondering what that looks like, because it is so intentional, and I can tell what your vision is when seeing the photographs.
I have a goal.
Okay.
I don't have plans. I that's how I kind of operate, because especially in a natural setting, things can change. Things can not be or not cooperate the way you thought or planned. So no, I don't make plans. I just set a goal and then adapt from there. And a lot of cases I found that actually works better if I have the place I want to shoot, the scene I want. And then once I get there, I have an idea of a goal, but once I'm there, then I adapt to that goal with what the scene is giving me and what the situation is giving me.
Yeah. How do you?
Because if I have a plan, I get too upset.
Yeah.
It doesn't work.
It doesn't work. The storm, the lighting's crazy, especially being outside. I mean, there's really no way to predict what's going to happen.
No.
Yeah.
No, and that's another reason why, excuse me, natural settings, especially wooded settings, the light is more even and controlled.
Sure, I never thought about that, but it makes so much sense.
With the time period, like the concepts that I was doing, it's a series of photographs, so that takes a series of time. Well, if you're outside in the sunlight, that light changes over that time period. So I either like overcast days where it's just an evenly overcast day where the light's nice and even and it doesn't change too much throughout the day, or a wooded area where there's a nice cast of even shade, even light, where there's no, where the light doesn't change that much through the day. And bright sunshiny days are a photographer's worst enemy anyway.
Yeah.
The light's like, too intense.
Yeah.
The light's too intense.
How much do your subjects play a role in what the final product of that shoot looks like?
That's just like just adapting to the scene.
Yeah.
Because they will bring a certain element. And when I have an idea in mind, a plan, a concept, I've worked with different people over time. I have an idea who I would like to use for that. I like people, I like to work with people that have been through some stuff. I find, number one, they're more interesting because their character is deep. There's more depth to their personality. And they just seem to work better and adapt more easily to what I want to do. It's just something that's really hard to put into words. The people that I like to work with for different situations, because I was talking to Barbara Toon, another artist in the building, one time about it, and she asked me about it, and I said, no, not every model will work for me. I told her, I said, I like broken
people. You like broken people? Yeah.
No, but I'm serious. But everybody has that, some more than others. But that brings another element into what I'm trying to create. And I did a concept using that. I asked the different people that I was working with. It was a reflection series where I used them and then a reflection and whatever it was, water on mirror, whatever it was. The goal was I wanted their personalities in this. So I said to them, what do you want to convey? Are there different things that you want to convey from yourself? So they came up with what they wanted to portray. I just set up the scene or whatever, the idea, but it was their input that really, I had one person that came through a drug addiction, and went through rehab and everything else, and she's recovered. She's fully recovered. She's very proud of herself, and she's done very well. But she wanted to show those two sides of her, and we did one. Actually, came in real early in the morning here at the God Awards,
yeah.
And we did it in the men's room, using the mirror in the men's room. But I thought that the bathroom scene with what she wanted to portray and what her past was, like, that kind of worked with that. But the images, I didn't do any direction. It was all her. It was all them, and how they felt and what they wanted to feel. Here's what I want to do to another one like that. I want another concept I had in mind for that type of thing.
When you have these ideas, they are so, they have such a richness and warmth to them when you're capturing these things. Is there times that you find your ideas come to you? Is it, because I sometimes folks say when they're like so calm and they take a couple days off work, then they have their best idea because they have some space. But where do your ideas pop into your head? Is it all the time? The cold of night?
Anywhere, anytime. I really can't pin it on anything. I don't sit down and think, oh, what can I think of?
Yeah.
It's usually something that inspires me.
Sure.
And that could be anything. That could be, for example, I did a series of the figures in a cloth. Mm-hmm. Well, that whole series was inspired by something that I found in my garage when I was cleaning out my garage. I found a piece of cloth that was over 30 feet long. It was a tube of cloth.
Huh.
It was like t-shirt material that just came off the knitting mill.
Yeah.
And I found that in my garage, and all these ideas flashed through my head as I was cleaning out my garage. And then, yeah, that's how that inspired. It can be anything. It could be anything. Be something I've gone through or going through personally that inspires it. Something I witnessed going, you know, out in the world. It could be a person that inspires me to do a shoot. The one concept I did, I had a shelf with all these different faces, all these heads. It was the same person, but it was what inspired that shoot was I worked with this model. She was so very expressive in her face, mm-hmm. like so many different expressions. She was, not everybody can do that.
Yeah.
Not everybody can show all kinds of different emotions, very pronounced. Like she couldn't, her expressions were inspired that shoot where I now on shelves, all these different faces and all these different expressions and mood are lined up on the shelf where the idea is she can pick whatever would want she wants. It's called choices. What do you choose to be that day or what do you choose to be at that time?
That's so accurate. Even to say through time and what yourself, what your expression looked like. I mean, there's so many ways to look at a piece like that. That's so wonderful. You have so many interesting props hanging out around here. What is the funkiest thing that you came across? I mean, the tube of fabric could be one, but what is the funkiest thing you came across that sparked a concept? There's a lot.
A toilet in the woods.
A toilet in the woods. So what? What sparked it? Did you just have a toilet and you're like, well, I gotta do something fun?
I saw it. I was driving somewhere. I was driving to my mom's place and I was going through this back road through some woods, and about 30 yards off the road in the woods was this toilet.
Huh.
Somebody dumped it. Somebody set it there to get rid of it. And when I saw it, I was like, and again, got these ideas and found a model that went out and we shot out at that toilet. And that was a thing on eating disorders, mm-hmm. that I did a concept, and it was titled Emptiness. And it's just her at the toilet out in the woods, but the emptiness was also the scene too, because it's not a thick wood, it's kind of a sparse wood. You'd have to see, it's hard to explain, but. Everything's online, by the way.
Yeah. Soul imagery. Please look. Like, send some time. Hopefully you're scrolling on your phone through this as you're listening. It was beautiful when, because I saw your event photography through my position at Berks Arts, but when you had sent me the link saying like, hey, these photos are ready to be edited, I saw this side menu of all these other like categories and concept that you have worked through and kind of got lost in all of the beauty of it. So it's definitely worth some exploring. It's so enjoyable to see also the range of what you do, because some things that when you look at concert photography, it's one thing, and then fine art and then nudes, and then moving forward to all these different pieces, it's really beautiful.
Oh, thank you very much.
To kind of dance around. Is it seasonal, or do you find yourself like some days I'm super focused on concert stuff?
Well, the concert stuff is kind of seasonal.
Yeah.
Especially with the festivals that's put on by the Berks Arts. And then your summer festival seasons and stuff like that. Yeah, that's kind of seasonal. A little bit in the wintertime, but not a whole lot. As far as the artwork, like conceptual fine art, I like naked trees more than leaved trees.
Huh.
To me, trees that are bare, so I like the fall, late fall, and sometimes the winter, and early spring. Shoot those seeds in nature, in those settings, because for me, you see the soul of the tree without the leaves. So that, like I said, everything's a character in the scene, and that kind of plays with that. Because in the summertime, all you got is a bunch of broccoli.
Yeah. the soul of the tree is such an interesting point. My partner recommended a really amazing book to me called Braiding Sweetgrass. And in that, the author has indigenous heritage and speaks about non-human people, because plants are people, and kind of appreciating and thanking it, the different treatment of the soul of plants. And it really reframes the mind when you consider nature to have its own being, which it does, but because of the world we live in, it's not taught that way. It's so special to hear that perspective and kind of reframe the mind.
That's part of that connection we were talking about a little earlier. That natural connection to those scenes. Yeah. And plus, the summertime is just too hot. It's like I was talking about, the sun's too high and too intense for a lot of the outdoor stuff.
Living in this area of the country, there's so many trees and there's so much color in the fall. Do you ever experiment with the leaves at that time just because of how much color there is, or is that the autumnal brightness?
Yeah, if I'm shooting that, I'm shooting it for that.
For that reason, yeah, that makes a lot of sense.
To capture that color. I don't necessarily want to use that in my concept, in my fine artwork, because again, I don't want too much of a distraction.
Sure, it's its own thing.
You want, like you said, the characters in the play. Some of those characters are background characters. Some of those are supporting characters. Some of those are main characters.
Yeah.
So the natural settings I like, because especially in the fall, late fall, winter, early spring, you don't have a lot of color depth. You have a lot of texture and light depth and shadow depth, but you don't have those colors that I don't want too much of a distraction, because colors are very powerful in it.
Absolutely.
So you have to be, I think as an artist, you have to be very careful with the use of it if you're trying to convey certain things.
That makes a lot of sense. I've noticed the pops of color in your photos, like sometimes there's a red item or something that jumps out, and it does make it look significantly more intentional because the rest of the photo has that not as vibrant of a background, but it is vibrant in texture and vibrant in space. And yeah, it's so unique to hear the story behind the character, to speak to you, because so many have seen your photos, whether it's in galleries or here at the Goggle Works or through event photography, but to speak to, the mind behind the camera is just so exciting. It's exciting. Do you have any projects that, or concepts that you're excited to execute in the near future, like any things that you're like, I'm really going to do this?
Yes, actually, there was one idea I had in mind, which I touched on briefly, they're talking about that reflection series.
Yeah.
I have the scene. It's an old caboose, train car caboose. And in the back of it is a table. And I liked it for the textures of it. It's kind of an abandoned looking. The colors are washed. They're not real intense. And I love the textures in it, the way it is. But there, in the back of the caboose is a table and there's a bench on either side. And my idea, goal, is I want to use the same person, the same model in the concept. But here's where I want that person to have their input. I want to have them gambling with themselves.
Oh, wow.
Like playing poker with themselves. And it's the whole thing is about, what are you willing to wager as a person to be a certain way?
And that's it's going to so
be,
powerful.
Because it'll be the same person, but I had four, you know, maybe four or five, four or five different positions for this person. And each one is going to be a different version of themselves.
Wow.
That's where I want their input into it.
Yeah. What, who are the yous, you know, like what is, wow. It's so interesting also to consider the,
like, and that's where I like the people that have been through some stuff because they have more to pull from. And the more they've been through, the deeper they can go to pull from.
Sure.
And that's my whole idea behind that. The deeper the person's personality, the more experiences they have had helps with those things that I'm looking for.
Yeah. And also the distinct differences between the selves, you know, when you've been through something or you've had time or you've gone through phases in life, those characters that are gambling and wagering and expressing may have had a little bit more
That's what I mean. That's where there's some folks that have really gone through a whole lot. Like that one we did in the men's room here, with the situation she went through. The more drastic of a change between those two points in a person's life, the more they are gonna have to the depth.
Yeah.
The depth in their personality. That's the easiest way I think I can explain it.
So where do you find your subjects? Is it friends? Is it people you run into? Because you have to know them a tad to know if they've been on a journey.
Yeah, the person that, like I said, the person that we did in the men's room, as I was talking about, I've known her since high school. And she's the same age as I am now. So I've known her a long time. And I kind of saw, some of the things. But there was a personal relationship there, but I find people that come through and walk through and say, hey, that's really neat. Really attractive. Hey, I'm constantly looking for new faces and they don't want to use the same person all the time. There are a few people that I really love to use, but I don't want to use the same person all the time because I want the work to change a little bit to have a different look and more the different personalities that will give me that more depth in the portfolio too.
Wonderful. Well, I think that we've ran out of time for today, but I am so grateful to have had you here to share a little bit of your work and to know more about what happens behind all of these photographs, because they are so deep, and like learning more about the concepts is such a blessing. For those at home listening, please check out Soul Imagery. Kevin Brett is the photographer and the mind behind those photographs. You can see the Zen Folio online with different series of photographs and categories. And you also might bump into him if you're around the festivals for Berks Arts. He's always around in a smiling face.
Soul-imagery.com.
Yes, we're grateful to have you here and have you in this community. It's really
wonderful. I really appreciate the opportunity. Thank you very much.
Thank you. Have a wonderful evening, everyone.
Bye-bye.